as inferior to the enforceable fundamental right. In the very beginning, in the subcommittee of the drafting the fundamental rights subcommittee, it was specifically drafted what is presently we find Article 37 of the Constitution. If you read the language of Article 37 today, the principles given in this part, that is part 4, are not enforceable in the court of law. Nevertheless, they are fundamental in the governance of the country. And it goes on further. It shall be the duty, shall makes it mandatory, it shall be the duty of whom? Of the state. It shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making of the laws. Such great people, they could draft the language of this article in unequivocal terms. That though these principles are going to be unenforceable, not enforceable, but still they are fundamental in the governance of the country. And it is the duty of the state. State includes, as you all know, under Article 12 of the Constitution, all the three wings of the state. The legislature, the executive, the judiciary. We know it. It is the primary responsibility of the legislature to make the law. But we know it also under delegated legislation, even the executive makes the law. And judiciary, of course, under Article 141 of the Constitution, when the Supreme Court declares, that is binding on all the authorities of in the country. And what is binding? Which has the force of law. So the other two organs, other than legislature, they also make the law. They may be making the laws interstitiously. Rawls, the draft constitution, which was presented on October 7, 1947, had one part, which was labeled as part 3 of the constitution. It had three chapters in it. Particularly to the students, I would mention that in many of the books it is mentioned chapter 3 deals with fundamental right and chapter 4 deals with letter principle. It is wrong. It is part 3 and part 4. In Rawls' draft, which I said was presented on October 7, 1947, the part 3 contained three chapters. And chapter 1 was what is present today. It was named as a general, titled as a general. It contained what is we have today, Article 37, which I have just now narrated to you. Chapter 2 dealt with the fundamental rights, and chapter 3 dealt with the director principle, what we have today. The drafting committee ultimately, 20 days thereafter, shifted this chapter 3 to part 3A of the constitution, which now is in the form of part 4 of the constitution as director principles. I have tried to give you this small history, that when the framer of the constitution, or prior to that even our freedom fighter, started demanding certain civil and political rights, they were convinced that civil and political rights are of no use, they have no meaning unless there are social and economic rights also, and they were clubbed together under the same heading. This kind of a conflict which we are envisaging today, which we have seen in a post-constitutional era after the commencement of the Constitution. This was envisaged by the framer of the Constitution, and that is why Article 37 was drafted in such a language to recognize the importance of the director principles of the state policy. Now comes the question, what is the true nature of the director principles? The girl who was introducing here, she very rightly mentioned about the preamble promise of socio-economic justice, which reflect both fundamental rights as well as the director principles. I repeat at the cost of repetition, fundamental rights are the negative rights, are the rights of the individual. They are enforceable rights. Why do we call them negative rights? Because if you read the language of most of the articles given in part 3 of the constitution, which are designated as fundamental right, it puts a limitation on the power of the state to make the laws. State shall not do. It's in the negative sense. State shall not do this, state shall not do that. No citizen shall be discriminated. It starts with the negative, this thing. And but they are rights given to each of us as individual, as our fundamental rights. When you talk about directive principles, they are positive rights. As compared to the negative, they are positive rights because they mandate the state. State shall do. State shall make an endeavor. You read any article of part 4 of the constitution, they give the command to the state to do something positively for, not individually, but for all the people of the country. And therefore, the directive principles are in the nature of collective rights, but they are unenforceable in the nature as Article 37 itself says. The sole aim of the directive principle was to bring about a socio-economic revolution, real equality in the country through a peaceful revolution. Because the freedom fighter, they had seen the violent struggle. They never wanted there should be a violence in this nation after we have attained the political freedom. And if the people of the nation, they have their social equality, they have their economic equality, they are not suffering from hunger, they have satisfaction to their basic needs, then they can exercise their civil and political rights in a more meaningful manner. We must understand that the fundamental rights and the directive principle, they are part of the same constitutional scheme, and as such, except the part of enforceability, there is no distinction between the fundamental right and directive principles. I'll draw your attention to two very important articles, one of which I have already mentioned, Article 37, which talks about non-enforceability of directive principles, but at the same time that they are fundamental in the governance of the country and the duty of the state in applying the making of laws. On the other hand, read Article 13 of the Constitution. Article 13, Clause 1 says, all laws which are inconsistent with Part 3 of the Constitution shall, to the extent of contravention, they shall be not valid, they shall be void. And Clause 2 put a further prohibition. State shall not make any law contravening the fundamental rights. Therefore, the recognition was on the importance of both the fundamental rights as well as the fundamental in the nature of the governance of the country. When we speak about non-enforceability, we have to go a little deeper in understanding the meaning of non-enforceability. There is a difference between non-enforceability and non-cognizance by the court, because constitutional duties cast upon the state to implement these laws while making the laws. So we cannot say that they are of such a nature that no cognizance is to be taken. Normally those, not that I have understood the nature thoroughly, but those who criticize the directive principle, they say, you compare them from where we have taken these principles. Everybody will say, all books mentioned, we have taken from Irish Constitution. The corresponding article is Article 45 of the Constitution. 45 of the Irish Constitution. But if you want to understand that, have we borrowed it as such lock, stock and barrel to our Constitution Part 4 or the directive principles? Or, while taking guidance from Article 45 of the Irish Constitution, have we incorporated them with some modification? And if with some modification, what is the impact of those modifications? Then only we can appreciate that whether there is a distinction between Article 45 of the Irish Constitution and the Part 4 of the Constitution in the form of directive principles. If you compare the two, you will find in Irish Constitution, in Article 45, it is mentioned the principle therein shall not be cognizable. In our case, it is mentioned they shall not be enforceable. I have tried to distinguish between the two. Enforceability is one thing when you can ask the state, okay, this is my right, this is my right, you give it to me, enforce it. Cognizability is that I will come to it when I come to the implementation of director principle, how the cognizance has been taken even by the Indian courts in implementing the director principles. Secondly, in Article 45 it was mentioned the principles are for the general guidance of the Irish Parliament, whereas in our case they were declared fundamental in the governance of the country, not for the general guidance. Though we say director principle are the directives to the state, they must take them into consideration while making the law, but simultaneously they were declared as fundamental in the governance of the country. And third, that in the Irish constitution it is mentioned that application of the principles of social policy shall be the care of the parliament, whereas Article 37 last part says it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making of the laws. So if you see the contents of Article 45 of the Irish constitution, which formed the basis or a foundation of incorporation of director principle in our constitution, we did not just lifted that article and planted in our constitution. We made significant changes, and the changes were made keeping in view the significance of the principle which the framers of our constitution wanted in the nature of the director principle. Be that as it may, after the commencement of the constitution, no other part came for the close scrutiny before the courts as the part 4. Of course, there are other provisions like state emergency, etc., which were subsequently. I confine my lecture today only to part 4 of the constitution. I have immense regard to the great constitutional writers like Professor Upinder Bakshi, living legend, living luminary, former Vice Chancellor of Delhi University, Professor Emeritus of Warwick University. We had, we still have in fact, a monumental commentary on constitution by Sirwai. And before his death, he wrote in his will that nobody will revise his monumental work. And that work remains a classic commentary on the constitution. And we had one of the greatest lawyers of the nation, Palkhivala, who fought most of the constitutional cases, Palkhivala, but we are not Palkhivala. Palkhivala was only one and one. I have a limitation. The later two are not here in this world, they are in the heaven. Upinder Bakshi is not present in the hall. Legally speaking, I have neither a legal authority or a moral authority to criticize them. But academically, yes, this liberty is there that we can evaluate their views on the director principles. I start with Upinder Bakshi. Upinder Bakshi was of the view that it is a misnomer to call them fundamental in the governance of the country. Why? He said, some of the director principle can be attained after some time, and once you achieve the objective of those principle which is enshrined in a particular provision of the director principle, then they cease to be fundamental. So by calling them they are fundamental in the governance of the country, they don't become superior, they don't become so fundamental. And his example was Article 40, organization of village panchayat. You have established village panchayat system, the objective is attained. What is fundamental thereafter in Article 40? Article 44, uniform civil code. We have not been able to implement this Article 44 till date. But if you have a uniform civil code, we have taken so many decades to have a Lokpal bill passed in the parliament. Maybe tomorrow, in the 21st century, the next generation sees some uniform civil code also. The political changes are taking place so fast in the country. So once Article 44 or the uniform civil code is enacted, the goal is attained. What is remaining about fundamental about that article? Similarly, he also mentioned Article 45, free and compulsory education. Though this goal has been achieved on paper by enacting Right to Education Act itself after so many years, but it remains only on paper. The living reality, you know, how many children between the age of 6 to 14 years, they are still working on the roadside hammers, tea stall, and various other avocations. Instead of going to the school, they do not know the meaning of school yet. Anyhow, that's a totally a different part, a different story. Upendra Bakshi was also of the view that no law can be declared void if it conflicts with the director principles. My submission is that the Constitution does not differentiate between different director principles. If you read the part 4 of the Constitution with the writer of Article 37, all the director principles have been declared as fundamental in the governance of the country. No director principle is less important or more important as far as part 4 vis-a-vis other provisions of the Constitution is concerned. Therefore, there may be a limited truth seeing the nature of the director principle from the eyes of Upendra Bakshi, but I am of the considered view that director principles, since they constitute a part of the Constitution, which is the fundamental law of the land, and there is no differentiation between the different provisions, they all remain on equal footing, they are all equally important, they all remain fundamental in the governance of the country. Sirvai has attacked the director principle in a very, very forceful manner, and it becomes really difficult to rebut his forceful arguments on the nature of the director principle. When I was a student, I read his second edition in 1976. He wrote in his second edition, director principles can't be equated with fundamental right. They are inferior in status. Categorical statement. Director principles cannot be equated with fundamental rights. They are inferior in status. Later in the third edition, when I was a young lecturer, not that I am very old now. I may be old, but I don't yet consider myself that old. In 1984, Sirvai went to the extent of making a statement in his third edition. Nothing would have happened if director principles were not made as a part of the Constitution. He did not stop there. He further wrote in his third edition that director principles being non-enforceable, not a law at all. He said they are not a law at all, because I said in the, while describing Article 141 earlier, what do you call it a law? Law is something which is binding, which is enforceable. Since they are not enforceable, they are not even having the nature of law. Probably he was talking in the Austinian sense. Law is the command of the sovereign. The student of jurisprudence know it very well. But I salute Sirvai. He never used to make a blanket statement without a sound reasoning. To justify these two statements, In the third edition, if you go in 1984, he raised five very, very pertinent, important questions to describe the nature of director principle. His first question was, do the word fundamental, with the quote fundamental, and the word duty, as mentioned in Article 37, have the same meaning? If not, what is the practical impact of that? He raised the question and then answered those questions. Second question was, is the position different? If in place of duty, have the same, sorry, in place of duty, we speak about a constitutional mandate which is binding. There is a difference. Article 37 talks about only duty. But if you use the word or expression constitutional mandate, then what could have been the difference? What is meant by, which is a popular phrase used by the judiciary, because by that time, Sirwai had seen number of judicial decisions and the views of the Supreme Court. He said, what is meant by when it is said that fundamental rights and director principles are complementary and supplementary to each other? That is the normal expression which the judiciary had been using after the commencement of the Constitution. The fourth question he raised was, are fundamental rights robbed of their contents and meaning if the state fails to implement the director principles? Because he said, nothing would have happened had the director principles not been enacted. So his question was, if director principle, even if they are in the constitution and they are not implemented, can we say the fundamental rights will be robbed of their contents and meaning? If not, his argument is justified, nothing would have happened had the director principle not been enacted. And the last question, very important question raised by him was, do the fundamental rights prevent the state from implementing the director principles? Where is the conflict? If fundamental rights are given in part 3, the director principles are given in part 4, do the fundamental rights restrict the don't implement the director principles? He gives his explanation to each of these questions. I'll go one by one. He said the word fundamental and the duty used in part 3 and part 4 of the Constitution are used in different senses. He says the word fundamental is qualified by the word rights, and it is legally binding law. Violating there can be declared as void. Whereas, he said, the word fundamental used in part 4 of the Constitution, particularly when we say fundamental in the governance of the country in Article 37 of the Constitution, it is only in the normative sense, and law cannot be declared as void. That is what his views is explaining. He said the word duty in part 3 is legally enforceable, whereas the duty in part 4 is only a moral duty, it is not a legal duty. My answer to his argument, of course, I beg pardon again, Sirwai is not there to rebut my argument, and it is not fair, but academically, what I try to find answer to this is, when we talk about fundamental, the word fundamental in fundamental rights, and fundamental in the governance of the country in part 4, can we say what is fundamental in the governance of the country is less important than what is fundamental for the individual? Fundamental rights are the rights of individuals. Directive principles are the social economic rights, collective rights of we the people. So what is fundamental in the governance of the country? Can we call that in a normative sense as it is less important than what is fundamental for individual? If you see Article 38 to 51, then we find that except Article 49, the word obligation was used, and the state is duty bound to apply these principles in the making of laws. The significance of fundamental rights or the directive principle, if you want to understand, I think the present generation need not to go to the annals of history in studying. They must study the case of 2012, popularly known as the Ram Lila Maidan case, where when Baba Ramdev tried to have a dharma, and how the police attacked in the night, and he had to run for shelter to take shelter himself. The Supreme Court has said that on the one hand, the right and the liberty of the individual is important, but at the same time, the social and economic right, the people, right of the people to get together, to have their voice, to have the exchange of words, to have their feelings expressed, is equally important. What is the meaning of freedom of expression, speech and expression, if I have the freedom of speech and expression only within the four walls where nobody is hearing me? I can have a meaningful freedom of speech and expression where I can exchange my views, I can listen to the views of others. Either I can get convinced with the views of others, or I can convince others. Then only the freedom of speech and expression becomes meaningful. I go a step further. Non-enforceability does not prevent the state from examining the validity of the laws which are being violative of the directive principles. Non-fulfillment of directive principle may lead to two conclusions, or two consequences rather, not conclusion, but the consequences. One, since they are laying a positive obligation on the state to do something in the positive sense, if the state does not do what is directed them to be done in the different directive principle, it may lead to constitutional crisis. You have seen one example, I reiterate again. Article 45 of the Constitution was the only provision in the entire Constitution which laid a time limit for the government to achieve the objective within 10 years from the commencement of the Constitution, to provide free and compulsory education within 10 years. We commenced the Constitution in 1950. This directive was to be achieved by 1960. The Supreme Court declared right to free and compulsory education as a fundamental right in 1992 and 93. Moni Jain case subsequently clarified in Unni Krishnan Jain's case. And the Parliament enacted the law by amending the Constitution.